Good afternoon to one and all. I, Hiba Farin, an academic consultant in English of Odisha State Open University, today we're going to start a session on Indian writings in English, particularly R.K. Narayan's The Guide. So I would like to thank Odisha State Open University for providing us this platform. Online sessions. So before starting the need to first was and what all his contribution are to the literary realm. So R.K. Narayan, his full name is Rashipura Krishna Swami Narayan. Originally he was called Rashipuram Krishna Swami Narayana Swami. He was born on October 10th 1906 in Madras, and he died in May 13, 2001, Madras. So he is considered to be as one of the most finest Indian authors of his generation that he wrote in English. So he was reared by his grandmother Narayana and Narayan, and he completed his education in 1930. And really worked as a teacher before devoted himself to writing. His first novel we come to know as The Swami and Friend, that was written in 1935. So it's an episodic narrative recounting the adventure of a group of schoolboys. So that book and much of Narayan's later work are set in a fictitious small Indian town of Malgudi. So Narayan typically portrays peculiarities of human relationships, ironies of Indian daily life, in which modern urban existence clashes with the ancient tradition. So, and his style is quite graceful and is marked by genial humor, elegance and simplicity is there. And he is considered to have received the best, among the best received of the Narayan 34 novels are The English Teacher, that was written in 1945, then Waiting for the Mahatma, that was written in 1955, and The Guide, that was written in 1958, then Malgudi, The Man Eater of Malgudi, that was written in 1961, The Vendors of Sweet, that was written in 1967, and A Tiger for Malgudi, that was written in 1983. So he has lots and lots of contribution, literary works that he wrote, and even he wrote short stories. A collection includes The Lowly Road, that was written in 1956, A Horse and Two Goats, and other stories that was written in 1970. Under the Banyan Tree and other stories that was written in 1985. So these adds to the bulk of his literary work, and even he contributed in the non-fiction as well, and he even published a modern prose version of in Ramayana that was published in 1972 and Mahabharata in 1978. So these are his contribution in the literary realm. So before starting the topic, The Guide, is the title justified, The Guide, or is it a travesty that can be debated about the as the topic, the name of the novel? Can it's debatable whether it's a true, whether we are speaking the title in its way, that is it a true guide that can be trusted, or is it a travesty that is to be questionable? So The Guide, that was published in 1958, it received Sahitya Academy Award in 1961. And like quite a number of other novels by Narayan, it had its genesis in an incident from real life. And it in his autobiography entitled My Days, Narayan recollects how around 1956 and 57, he has been musing over the subject of a new novel about seven sufferings, enforced sainthood. So the outline of a plot came to him following something that happened around that time in his hometown of Mysore. So there was a severe drought had dried up all the rivers and tanks, and even the Krishna Rajasagar. So a huge reservoir that helped to irrigate several thousands of acres now revealed its cracks, beds to the fiery sky. So, and exposing an ancient temple and dehydrated crocodiles. In extreme desperation, the municipal council decided to resort to rituals and prayers. So, a group of Brahmins from the parched bed of the river Kaveri submerged up to their knees in water, which had been ferried to the spot at Great Coast, fasting and chanting mantras for 11 days and nights. So on the 12th day, the rain came and the countryside was saved from impending famine. So the idea of a story based on this episode of a ritual fasting for rain, which would tie up with the motive of enforced sainthood, germinated in Narayan Mai till his visit to the US in 1957 on a Rockefeller Foundation grant. And another incident there as Narayan record in his travel narrative in America entitled My Dateless Diary, An American Journey, quite by chance helped him to conceptualize the character of Raju, the hero of the guide. The section can be entitled as the super guide in the chapter, The New York Days, relates how a very efficient guide, witty, smart, familiar, factual, took the author and his group around the National Broadcasting Corporation studios at the Rockefeller Center. So the young man's smooth speech was more vivid and picaresque than the actual exhibits on display. So he seemed to conjure up history and archaeology out of thin air. So one can almost see Narayan shaping the character of Raju from his chance encounter. So shortly after this, he moved to Berkeley in California, hired a hotel room for 3 months and wrote the novel straight through it. Okay. And it can be said that the story of the guide and the character of the Raju were suggested by real life incidents. And so apparently were some of the other characters. Ved Mehta quotes Narayan as telling him that some family incidents had inspired the creation of Rosie and Marco. So Narayan, in fact, was a kind of writer who constantly translated his keen observation of life into the stuff of his fiction. So as he noted in the problem of the Indian writer, the novelist has had to live close to life. His mind must pick out the tale from life, shape it, and use it. So he is likely to be always busy planning the next chapter. Okay. And we also know that how the film that was shot in English and Hindi version, a distinguished group of Americans were to produce the English version with a screenplay by Nobel Prize winner Pearl Buck to make it more exotically Indian. The American producer decided to include a scene featuring two tigers fighting each other, which is not in the novel, right? So Narayan promptly decided to have as little to do with this version as possible. As for the Hindi version, for which Devanand regularly consulted the author, but apparently paid little heed to his suggestion. So Narayan is gently satirical and marked this actually in color and wide screen first time in the history of this. So we are beginning with the narrative structure and the moment. So that the story, what's the story is all about. So guide is a story of Raju, a lovable rogue who rises from a humble origin to become a successful tourist guide in Malgudi. He then makes and loses a fortune through his association with Rosie, that is later known as Nalini, a talented dancer who is abandoned by her husband Marco after he discovers his lesson with Raju. So Raju is sent to jail for forging Rosie's signature, but through a strange combination of circumstances, after his release, he is cast in the role of a holy man, Swami or Sadhu by Velan, a simple peasant from the village of Mangal. So at the end of the novel, Mangal and the surrounding countryside suffer a terrible drought due to the failure of the monsoon rains. The villagers who by now regard Raju the saint and revere him as their guru appeal to him to save them and prevail upon him to undertake a ritual fast to appease the rain god. So unable to resist the faith in him, though he is skeptical about the outcome, so Raju embarks on a 12-day fast with extremely ambiguous consequences. He collapses, clearly to die on the 11th day, with only a strong intuition but no certainty that the rain will indeed come. So, however, the denouement strongly suggests that Raju, the confident trickster and the fake sadhu, has redeemed himself through his self, sir, the self-sacrifice. The events of the story can be counted as The novel charts the story of Raju's life from birth to death, but it begins not at the beginning, but in the middle of his life, or is medias res, as normally as happens in epic. So Raju has just been released from prison and is mistaken for a holy man by Villan, whom he meets on a riverbank. So Villan is worried that his stepsister will not marry the man chosen for her and ask Raju for his advice. So Raju offers to speak to the girl. The chapter also contains part of the story of Raju's life as narrated to Villan. We learn about Raju's childhood spent between his father's small hut shop and his mother and his house and his home opposite the site where the Malguri railway station was being built. And in next chapter, we come to know that the first part of the chapter continues with the reminiscence of Raju's childhood. Spent between playing at the railway construction site and reluctantly attending the village school. And the second part moves forward to the present and Villan's problem. His rebellious sister is so impressed with Raju's advice that she apologizes to her elders and consent to the marriage, thus convincing the simple village folk that Raju is a wise man with supernatural powers. So Raju attempts to escape from this false position, but is finally forced to submit to their misconception and continues to play the role of their guru as he has nowhere else to go. The third chapter carries on with Raju's childhood memories, the highlight of which was the arrival of the first train at Malguri station. His father strategically placed food stall opposite the station, saw such an increase of customers from among the railway passengers that the family were able to buy a horse-drawn carriage and empty and employ a groom. So then Raju's father invested in a larger grocery shop right on the platform, and Raju, to his relief, was withdrawn from school to look after the hut shop. The chapter begins in the present with Raju convincing the villagers of Mangal to give. So the chapter begins in the present with Raju convincing the villagers of Mangal to give serious attention to the education of their children. So he starts a school within the premise of the ruined riverside temple, which he has made his home. So though there is a village school master, Raju often addresses the school, the students himself. So very soon their parents too begin to stop by after their work in the fields to listen to his oration. So Raju reflects on how, after the death of his father, he had taken over the platform shop and converted part of the space into a stall for new and used books and papers. So most of his knowledge that so impresses the villagers actually comes from what he had read in those books. So by the end of the chapter, Raju has a large followings and has grown his hair and beard, thus firmly establishing himself in the image of Swami or a wise man. In chapter 5, still reminiscing over his past, Raju recalls how from running the platform stall, he had drifted into the task of assisting railway passengers who wished to go sightseeing till he became a full-fledged tourist guide. So known to all as Railway Raju, this is how he meets Rosie and her peculiar and scholarly husband, to whom he gives the nickname Marco. While Marco wants to photograph the carvings into the in the ancient caves high up on the Mempi hills for a book he is writing, so Rosie inexplicably wants to see a king cobra dance to the music of king a snake's charmer's flute. So Raju succeeds in arranging this and Rosie involuntary movement as she imitates the swaying cobra convinces Raju that she is a gifted dancer. Rosie, Raju discovers, is an educated. Rosie is an educated girl who comes from a family of low caste of Devdasi, or temple dancer, that's normally said. So she is passionate, devoted to Bharatanatyam. But Marco, who is married, whom she is married to, in spite of knowing her background, till he marries her and he's trying to throw his modernity or the sense of being a modern man who doesn't consider caste or the background lower caste knowledge. And in chapter 6, we have that the chapter runs to the present with Raju performing the role of a holy man with gusto for Villan and his fellow villagers and reveling in their adulations. But there is bad news all around. The drought is getting severe and the cattle are dying. Food is scarce. Shopkeepers are hoarding supplies and charging exorbitant prices. And the tents and harassed villages are getting into fights on the slightest pretext. So Raju intervenes and settles a major dispute, promoting villagers from the entire area to look on him as their savior. So it is now that Velan informs him that they expect him to undertake a ritual fast to end the drought. So Raju is in dilemma. He knows full well that he is no holy man with supernatural powers. He decides that it is time to drop the pretense and confess to Velan. So in chapter 7, it is as part of Raju's confession that we get to know about his affair with Rosie. While Marco remains busy with his work at the Peak House on Mempi Hills, Raju and Rosie spend endless hours in a hotel in Malgudi. Rosie feels that Raju is giving her a new lease of life by encouraging her to dance. Indeed, this is the main reason why she's attracted to Raju. Even though she feels guilty about betraying Marco, however, she gives away her secret with a chance remark, and the infuriated Marco leaves Malgudi, refusing to take her with him. Rosie has no option but to move into Raju's house, where her dancing and indeed her very presence scandalizes Raju's mother and uncle. So amid all these problems, Raju has neglected his once profitable platform shop, and railway authorities now serve him a notice to quit. So Raju is left to fend for his mother and Rosie without any source of income. So Raju run a bad luck continues. So he maintains creditor, the saint takes him to court for debt of over 8,000 rupees, and his old friend then Gafur, the taxi driver, distances himself because of Raju's refusal to break with Rosie. For the same reason, Raju's mother leaves their Malgudi home to go and live with their brother, Raju's uncle, in the village. So the only silver lining is that through Raju's effort, Rosie gets her first commercial dance engagement at the annual social of the Albert Mission School. In keeping with her new persona as a serious exponent of Bharatnatyam, Rosie adopts a stage name, Nalini. From that small beginning, Rosie or Nalini, meteoric rise as a classical dancer soon propels her to the summit of wealth and fame, and these are shared and relished by Raju as her agent and impresario. He hardly cares that his father's old house is sold to the saint by a court decree to pay off his debt. Since he now lives in Rosie's lavish mansion and associates with powerful and influential people, wealth has clearly corrupted Raju, though it has left Rosie strangely untouched. For her, Bharatnatyam is a kind of worship dedicated to the supreme dancer, Shiva and Nataraj, and she cares little for the material gain it brings in its wake. In fact, she has begun to resent the heavy performance schedule with which Raju burdens her in order to amass more and more money. So Raju's comfortable, self-serving existence is suddenly disrupted by two events, inexplicably. Marco sends a copy of his book on Mempi Hill Caves. The insecure Raju hides it from Rosie for fear that it will lead her to admire Marco's accomplishment. Unfortunately, Rosie reads a review of the book and then discovers that Raju has concealed it from her. The ensuing quarrel is the first major rift in the relationship. Then Raju intercepts a letter from Marco's lawyer addressed to Rosie, requesting her signature for releasing a box of jewelry held at a bank in their joint name. Feeling afraid that Rosie might want to re-establish contact with Marco and yet not wishing to forego her claim to the jewels, Raju forges Rosie's signature on the document within days, and he is arrested and imprisoned for forgery. So Rosie succeeds in getting Raju out on a 10,000 rupees bail after 3 days in a police lockup, but the relationship is never the same again. She discovers that there is a very little money left in her bank account and is aghast that her fabulous earnings has been squandered by Raju in luxurious living. After initially refusing to dance again, Rosie realizes that she must continue at least to be able to pay for Raju's trial. Once again, she is flooded with engagements, but the difference now is that she manages her career herself without Raju's help. When the trial begins, Raju's expensive adjournment lawyer that's paid for by Rosie tries to portray him as the hero who has saved Rosie from clutches of the insensitive and diabolic husband. But the circumstantial evidence gleaned from Raju's secretary, Mani, the postmaster and the handwriting expert are too damning, and Raju is sentenced to 2 years in prison. In prison, Raju is a model inmate, always ready to counsel and assist and tell moral tales, and soon even the most hardened criminals begin to call him Vadya or teacher. But his only visitor is Mani. So Rosie, as well as his uncle, his mother having died in the interim, appeared to have cut off all connections with him. And so when he is released, he has nowhere to go. So Raju's long confessional tale is over. And he had hoped that by telling it, he would be able to prove to Villan that he was no saint, and hence that he would not be able to redeem the villagers from the drought. But Villan is unmoved. India has had a long tradition of saints who were formerly sinners, and to his simple faith, Raju is yet another incarnation of that illustrious paradigm. So the die is cast, and Raju has to fast, standing on the dwindling water of the river, praying for rain. For the first few nights, he clandestinely eats from a secret hoard of food, but soon that too runs out, and in meantime, hordes of villagers flock from distant places to witness the holy rituals. Newspaper reports it, and American television company arrives to shoot the whole event as a documentary film, and government officials send a team of doctors to report on the Swami's health. On the 11th day of the fast, the extremely weak Raju collapses in the water and muttering, "Villan, it's raining in the hills. I can feel it coming up under my feet, up my legs," and he sacks down. There's a time shift in the telling of the story. And there's an episodic structure it can be seen in the novel. And even the double narrative can be found there, that the complicated interweaving of the past and the present to the inner and outer stories is conveyed in terms of a twofold plot or double narrative. So Raju himself recounts the sections relating to his past in the first person autobiographical mode. The sections relating to the present will basically deal with Raju's assumption of the role of the Swami, and its consequences are delineated by omniscient third person narrator or authorial voice. So the two narrative weaves in and out of each other in a braided structure that metaphorically represents the way in which a person past impinges on his present life. And in this case, entraps him. Raju is able to tell the story of his own past because being removed from it in time, he can see his mistakes objectively and assess his action with detachment. For example, reflecting back on his petulant behavior with Rosie when he is out on bail. So Raju is not able to see how unjust he was to Rosie. "I knew my mind was not working either normally or fairly. I knew I was growing jealous of her self-reliance, but I forgot for the moment that she was doing it all for my sake." This is a quotation from the novel. However, Raju cannot be the best narrator for the incidents of the present, that is, from his taking refuge in the abandoned temple near Mangal right up to his ritual fast, because he is too closely involved in a bewildering or self-serving or terrifying emotion generated by these experiences. So therefore, Narayan's strategy is to use the omniscient narrator to portray these portions of the story. The dual narrative told from this two points. One is subjective Raju and the objective omniscient narrator performs several dramatic functions in the text. So Raju's narrative, which takes us inside his mind and shows us how basically good man slides into unforgivable actions because of fairly innocuous defects in his character, helps the reader to be involved in Raju's fate and to sympathize with him. For example, Raju's musing on his growing affection for Rosie and his complicated feelings about her relationships with Marco help us to understand both his yearning and his insecurity. There was a lot of suspense and anxiety at the back of his mind, that I was nervous about what he would say to Rosie and really anxious that he should not hurt her. Also at the same time, a fear that if he became too nice to her, she might not care for me. I wanted him to be good to her, listen to her proposals, and yet leave her to my care. What an impossible, fantastic combination of circumstances to expect. 127 to 128, this line from the novel. So the authorial narration is, however, distances Raju through its ironic tone and marks his compromises and hypocrisies and locates him within a social and moral context on the boy, on the basis of which we can judge him. So here, for example, as are the passages, the essence of sainthood seemed to lie in one's ability to utter mystifying statements. So Raju soon realized that his spiritual status would be enhanced if he grew a beard and long hair to fall on his nape. A clean-shaven and close-haired saint was an anomaly. So by the time he arrived at the stage of stroking his beard thoughtfully, his prestige has grown beyond his wildest dreams. So this is the way, this is the representation of a saint, and he tries to fit in that posture. So we see how cynically Raju exploits the gullibility of villagers by consciously embracing the popular image of an Indian holy man. And he commercializes and markets spirituality. And it is only fitting that this same sham spirituality should entrap him at the end. The double narrative is also furthered by Narayan's styles of narration. The fact that despite everything that he does, the reader is not able to dismiss Raju as an evil man. And is due to Narayan's dexterous handling of the third person narrative. So, and it contains so much dialogue between Raju and the others and so much of free indirect discourse representing Raju's thought that even the omniscient strand of the narrative is never sufficiently detached from Raju as to allow the reader to censure him uncompromisingly. So here is a representative passage of depth transition between direct and indirect narration. So Raju almost glared at him, Velan, that is Velan. This single man was responsible for his present plight. Why would he not go away and leave him alone? What a wise plan it would have been if the crocodile had got him while he crossed the river. But that poor old thing, which had remained almost a myth, had become dehydrated. When its belly was ripped open, they found in it 10,000 rupees worth of jewelry. Did this mean that the crocodile had been in the habit of eating only women? So here the first sentence is authorial narration and gives us some objective information. And the next three sentences are free indirect discourse representing Raju's thought and acquainting us with his fears and frustration. And the remaining sentences on crocodile are a sudden shift based on association of ideas. But Raju being able to wonder even in the midst of his plight whether the crocodile ate only women suddenly gives us a flash of irreverent a mercurial Raju of earlier days who could see the humor in any situation and this draws the reader closer to him. The moral and the pattern that can be found in the guide is that insofar the novelists of India, the Indian writing in English were inspired primarily by the more European and American novels. So they may become the instruments for metamorphosis of the imported techniques into racial unconscious inherited by us from our tradition. So Narayan was well aware that the novel is a socially oriented bourgeois literary form having its own distinctive techniques and concerns which have been imported into India from the West. So the English language brought with it a new form such as a novel and short story revealing new artistic possibilities. New social awareness. So the Western fictional paradigm incorporated in the guide are building romance or a picaresque narrative. The wandering of a rogue, in fact. So the guide is a building romance or a picaresque or a rogue. But as Anand had intended, the Narayan too wished to fertilize this alien form with his own tradition. Traditional literature, style, material, inevitability become a background for one's own effort. Even if one generally writes of a modern society with recognizable characters and characteristics. So for Narayana, traditional literature, style and material always meant the Hindu legends and myths as narrated in epics and Puranas. So as regard the theme, the substance, content of these myths and legends, what we get are illustrations of moral, spiritual truths enunciated in Vedas. So the formal narrative qualities of the epics and Puranas are analyzed by Narayan and have interesting ramifications for the narrative patterns of the guide. So Narayan identifies three major narrative devices in those ancient texts. So the first is a poetic setting, usually a cool grove on a riverbank where the assembled sages question and seek illumination from a visitor who comes from afar. Each tale invariably starts off when an inquiring mind asks an enlightened one a fundamental question. Second is a dramatic dialogue, that's the dialogue-based question and answer format, starting from an initial exploratory question and going on to more probing questions and more revelatory answer. And lastly, a layered narrative that is structured with time shift. So Ramayana, that was written by Valmiki, who heard the story from Narada, who got it from Brahma, who had heard it from great God himself as a divine counsel. And so each tale goes back and further back. So other epics also have similar structures. A South Indian critic with access to Tamil, the Narayan's mother tongue, has compared the narrative technique of the guide to mythical Tamil epic Manimekhalai, a technique that takes us backward and forward through time. As with the epics, so with Puranas, we have a layered and digressive text based on interrogative framework, referring to the stylistic devices of Puranas. As H. Wilson rightly says that the invariable form of Puranas is that of a dialogue in which some person relates its contents in reply to the inquiries of another. So this dialogue is an interview with other, which are repeated as having been held on other occasions between different individuals in consequence of similar questions having been asked. And another indigenous pattern that's worked through guide is the linear progression of Varnasrama, or the Hindu belief in four stages of the ideal life. That's student, householder, rituals, and ascetic. That is Brahmacharya, Grihastha, Vatnaprastha, and Sannyas. So this pattern too is parodied in Raju, as successively a student preparing for life in platform vendor, and then Railway Raju phase, a householder, a man of affairs, in an illegal union with Rosie, and as a corrupt business manager, as Rakul during his days in prison, and an ascetic in his role as a fake guru. So Narayan's narrative strategy reinforces his theme, thus revealing in the guide an effective interaction of consent and form. So theme revolves around Raju's failure to fulfill the moral responsibilities of being a guide. So that is to show the true path and interpret it correctly. He behaves irresponsibly towards his tourists, to whom he lies, Marco, whom he deceives, Rosie, whom he misleads, and the villagers whose faith he almost betrays before recuperating his integrity at the end. So the narrative strategy supports the theme of demonstrating how at every stage Raju's career undercuts the saintly paradigm, which he is, as it were, heroically reenacting. So cumulative effect of this systematic subversion is Narayan's famed irony, which is directed both at Raju as well as at the vain hope of recuperating paradigm from antiquity in our corrupt modern times. The denouement of the novel can be pointed out as the complex moral world of the guide. It receives its fullest expression. So Raju is reenacting the penance of the sages of yore and is trying to bring rain to end the drought. So this is reminiscent of the story of sage king Bhagirath, who conducted severe penance to bring down goddesses Ganga, a story found in both Ramayana and Matsya Purana. So Raju's action is a travesty, of course, of these myths. But we shouldn't forget that in the view of his earlier knavery, his penance is on a personal level both a conversion and a catharsis. For the first time in his life, he was making an earnest effort. He felt suddenly so enthusiastic that it gave him a new strength to go through with the ordeal. But what is it that really happens at the end? We know from sources outside the novel that Raju dies at the end. Here is a relevant passage from Narayan's My Dateless Diary. Like Graham Greene liked the story when I narrated it to him in London. When he was hesitating whether to leave my hero alive or dead at the end of the story. So Graham was definite that he should die. So I have on my hands the life of a man condemned to death before he is born, and I have to plan my narrative to lead to it. So, however, Nothing to define, nothing so definite is indicated by the text. He sat down, although rebirth is hinted at. So they held him as if he were a baby. But what of the rain? Raju is surely now at this point a good man, and his mother, we remember, used to quote from her old Tamil poem that if there is one good man anywhere, the rain would descend for his sake and benefit the whole world. So if faith and goodness are the only criteria, the rain is bound to come. But why are we not told this so that the novel can have a satisfactory, heartwarming conclusion that God is in heaven and all's right with the world? The mythological allusions in the text are important here. So Raju refers twice to Devaka, who functions in the novel as a kind of mythic prototype of Raju. So one of the references is he, Devaka, was a hero, saint, or something of the kind. I never learned fully what he did or why. So this is exactly how we react to Raju. Moreover, Devaka's identity is ambiguous. The Devaka of Raju's mother's story, a man of ancient times who begged for alms at the temple gate every day and would not use any of his collection without first putting them at the feet of gods, he does not match the story of well-known Devaka of Hindu mythology, a great king, son of Ahok and father of Devaki, the mother of Lord Krishna. But Raju's version resembles that the last phase of his own life when he took refuge at the abandoned temple and revived through for his own purpose. The cult of the neglected deity of the temple, this ambiguous Devaka, is a more fitting subtext for Raju's life than the archetypal sage king Bhagirath. So finally, the Raju's self-sacrifice render the guide a triumphantly Hindu novel. The entire ritual, which had actually been concocted by Raju, may or may not have worked, but it did help to bring peace to the strife-torn Mangal and turn the community back to religion. Though reluctant to undertake the ritual at first, Raju's self-sacrifice was ultimately voluntary and not enforced. He made a free decision to conquer the weakness of his spirit, and we may say that Raju redeemed himself by this unselfish act. But since we cannot make out whether he also redeemed the community by bringing rain through his penance, there's no real evidence can be found of a miracle. So the denouement is neither a rejection nor a defense of the Hindu faith. It gestures towards a complexity of life in which there are no simple solutions. It is this ambiguous and open-ended denouement that raises the novel far above the level of a mere moral favor story with a simplistic, happy ending. This novel can be also seen through the lens of the feminist perspective. That first of all, we will be discussing about the title of the novel. The theme of the quest for spiritual fulfillment also explains the title of the novel. For within the Hindu cosmology, the path to spiritual illumination requires mentoring from a guru or guide. And there are multiple puns on the word guide. Raju goes from being tourist guide to Rosie's mentor or guide to the spiritual guide of the villagers of Mangal. So he is a born leader and people seek him out. It is written on the brow of some that they shall not be left alone. I am one such, I think. Although I never looked for acquaintance, they somehow came looking for me. So indeed, he has a kind of what a diviner's instinct for sensing what people need or want to hear. It was in his nature to get involved in other person's interests and activities. But Raju is a travesty of guide because he actually misguides people. And he lies to his tourists, deceives Marco, exploits Rosie, and cheats the trusting villagers with mock humility. He convinces the gullible villagers that he is the repository of divine wisdom. I am but an instrument accepting guidance myself, but instead of giving them the illumination they seek, he only confuses them with his empty platitudes, dragging those innocent men deeper and deeper into the box of unclear thoughts. So the title is therefore ironic, but it is ironic in more ways than one. For instead of guru, Raju guiding the career of his disciple or Sishya Vilan, it is Vilan who through his dot's devotion imposes his will on Raju's career and forces him to become some kind of yogi. So Raju's old habit of affording guidance to others rebounds on him, and he finds himself forced to accept the guidance of Vilan and undertake the fast. So the novel raises disturbing question about giving and receiving spiritual guidance in modern world. If Raju is at fault for exploiting the hold over people that he enjoys in his various roles as guide, the tourists and Marco and Rosie and the villagers are in a sense equally at fault for their gullibility. The title gently ridicules the uncritical application of tradition to modernity without hard rejecting tradition. In the final analysis, the title takes us beyond the specific destiny of Raju, the individual, and invites us to ponder on these larger issues. So dealing with Raju, so who this personality was, and then who this Rosie was. So in Guide, Narayan seeks to explore the psychological and situational complexities of enforced sainthood as a reluctant guru, like his creator Narayana, when faced with eager questions about Hindu spirituality in America. So Raju resists the role of wise man only to succumb to it, but the progression is fraught with irony. Raju's career is a parodic reenactment of the dedicated lives of the sages of yore. As in The Duty of Adept, he answers his inquirer, villain, but with a masquerade as regard his inner being. So Raju himself is aware that he has shown lack of judgment, lack of ordinary character. This circumstance compels him to discover a reservoir of strength, which he did not know he possessed, and he may indeed have ultimately attained godhood, but that matter remains open to question. So Raju is a type of godman who is a familiar figure in contemporary India. Through Raju, Narayan problematizes the ancient yogic paradigm of the saint, of the sant and sadhu, by transposing it on a modern setting and then probing the way in which it negotiates the many venalities of modern life. So Narayan was a man of too much common sense to idealize India's mythic past. In his essay, The Golden Age, he wrote, "Historians are fond of mentioning a golden age in their books. Our thoughts are nowadays trained to run on lines of employment, economics, etc., which complicates our views of Ram Rajya. I am sure that in any golden age, even in actual Ram Rajya, people must have cherished their grouses." So as a man familiar with traditional stories, so Narayan must also have known that many of the great spiritual guides of antiquity, like Valmiki, for instance, has had unsavory past, and the traditional folk tales very often featured fake swamis or heroes who were rascals. So in English in India, Narayan writes, "With the impact of modern literature, we began to look at the gods, demons, sages, kings of our mythology and epics, not as some remote concoctiers, but as types and symbols possessing psychological validity, even when seen against a contemporary background." And so through the character of Raju, who is portrayed as an anti-hero, Narayan explores the problems and possibilities of spiritual transcendence in a material world. So Raju is a quicksilver personality. He's capricious, he's mercurial, and even somewhat fickle. Because of his swift change of moods and desires, he is a bundle of contradictions. Raju is simultaneously duplicate nature he has, and a sincere, self-serving, unselfish, rogue, and redeemer, sinner, and saint. And it is this coexistence, complexity, duality of nature and venality in Raju's character that enables him to alter his person and improvise just as the situation demands. So Raju is by turn the railway vendor. He's a tourist and a guide, a family friend to Marco and Rosie, and he's a seducer, impresario, business manager, influential, but also a corrupt member of Malgudi high society. He's a swindler, he's a jailbird, he's a fake swami, and even a true ascetic. So such a dazzling trajectory of roles that he plays that is quite equally well and with equal gusto. He argues for a personality which may not have depth perhaps, but certainly has a wide range of interest and sensitivities. So Raju is far more intricately drawn than Narayan's other world, B. Sadhu. So Chandra of the Bachelor of Arts, indeed the care and detail which Narayan has lavished on the building of Raju's kaleidoscopic nature makes it quite clear that Guide was not intended to be a monologic allegory of Hindu beatitude, but a dialogic interplay of characters and situations. So Narayan has in fact said as much. My novel, The Guide, was not about saints or the pseudo-saints of India, but about a particular person. So through Raju, Narayan explores the enigma of human motivations and actions. One recalls in this connection his observation of on his own fictional method in a BBC interview with William Walsh. He said that my main concern is with human character, a central character from whose point of view the world is seen and who tries to get over a difficult situation or succumbs to it or fights it in his own setting. Well, this was his speech in an interview in BBC with William Nash. So in this novel, The Guide, Raju is both a focal point of the novel and the main internal focalizer in the novel. So that is the person from whose point of view the action and the other characters are seen and interpreted. So if we are looking for some kind of core for Raju's personality, a basic self amid the plethora of selves, it might be summed up in the metaphor of the guide or mentor. So Raju manifests the essential qualities of an effective guide in all his transitions as Malguri's tourist guide, Rosie's impresario or career guide, and the spiritual guide of the villagers of Mangal. He's affable, articulate, and intelligent, and he's indeed ironic how all these extremely positive qualities conspire to entrap him in various compromising situations because of the presence of one defect. His lack of judgment, as Raju himself admits this, seems to stem from a number of factors. His need to be liked by everyone he meets, his tendency to take the easy way out by refusing to face facts, his inclination to indulge himself. So this motivated throughout his life by these self-regarding instincts. So Raju's personal redemption is achieved when he finally puts the well-being of others above the claim of the self. So Raju's social nature and his quick mind and interest in varieties of subjects that is learned from scrap, which is unusual in a provincial youth of humble origin, is evident when he says that, I like to talk to people, I like to hear people talk, I like customers who would not open their mouths merely to put a plantain in and would say something on any subject except the state of crops, price of commodities, and litigation. So though lacking in formal schooling, Raju, even during his early years as a railway vendor, has a taste for social and intellectual life beyond his father's limited provincial boundaries, that is the state of the crops. It is in his quick observation, this power of assimilation, taste for the finer things of life, that enabled Raju to operate with ease among his social superiors such as Marco and later on with the influential people of Malguri. So this same quick tendency to accumulate and assimilate all kinds of information rather than engage in single-minded and serious pursuit of any one activity stands him in good stead, which he has to act as a holy saint. And he was surprised at the amount of wisdom welling from the depth of his being. He addressed them on all kinds of things. As Raju says of himself, in hindsight, reflecting back on his younger days, I'm convinced I was not such a dude. I remember how I was equipping my mind all the time. So in Raju, sociability goes hand in hand with affability. So it's written on the brow of some that they shall not be left alone, and I am one such. I think, although I never looked for acquaintances, they somehow came looking to me. So this is not just because of his easy charm, but because, as Raju himself realizes, that he has a capacity to be all things to all people, and he was blessed with a kind of water diviner's instinct about the right word or action in any situation. Anything that interested my tourist was also my interest. The question of my preference was secondary. So as one might expect of such an intelligent and adaptable young man, so Raju is also very resourceful. If someone wanted to see a tiger or shoot one, I knew where to arrange it. So it kept all of us happy and busy and well paid. And so he says that I never said that I don't know, not in my nature, I suppose. If I had had the inclination to say, I don't know what you are talking about, my life would have taken a different turn. Instead, I said, oh yes, a fascinating place. Haven't you seen it? You must find the time to visit it. Otherwise, your whole trip here would be a waste. I'm sorry I said it, and utter a piece of falsehood. It was not because I wanted to utter a falsehood, but only because I wanted to be pleasant. So this was his manner of talking to people in order to please them. and not for his own sake, but for the benefit or the making the conversation or the and way quite pleasant. So Railway Raju becomes the most popular tourist guide in Malgudi because it was in his nature to get involved in other person's interest and activities. So Raju is a natural guide also because he is a born leader. Even the village teacher succumbs to his authoritative demeanor. I will do anything under your guidance. And there is a gentle comedy as a teacher accepting a jailbird. Yeah, teacher used to, I will do anything under your guidance. That was a quotation. And there is a gentle comedy as a teacher accepting a jailbird as him. So we can even notice the pattern of dominance between Marco and Rosie, how she, though she was married to Marco, and yet she had a duality in her nature, being married to a high caste, and though she herself was quite educated, and she was a today's generation lady who was quite modern in her thinking, so it's self-dependent, and she didn't care about the normal traditions or the orthodoxical way of living, but still there was some loopholes in her character that made it quite questionable, and she herself agreed to that point. So the very pattern of dominance can be noted that R.K. Narayan, the guide, can be seen as a network of shifting power equation. And there are three major characters whose relationships are quite characterized by domination of one over the other. So the dominated characters use various ways to overcome their handicaps. So this struggle would be free from dominance, also results in search for individual identity. So these relationships shows an inequality, which is based not only on class, but also on gender. As rightly said by Kate Millett, who wrote in Sexual Politics, that the essence of politics is power, and that the most fundamental and pervasive concept of power in our society is male dominance. So what is true in context of gender politics is also true when class relationships are considered. In Guide at present points of time is that both Rosie and Raju appears as representing the subaltern. And the novel shows how they try to resist the discourse of dominance, which confronts them repeatedly. The relationship between Rosie and Marco is based on an inherent inequality of status. In the first place, Marco is a man who is rich, respectable, enjoys a relatively high social status. Although Rosie has a university degree and she is not her husband's equal in social status. She is a daughter of Devdasi, which itself places a double burden on her. She is a woman who has to mold herself according to the wishes of her husband, and secondly, she belongs to an inferior social caste. As Britta Olander speaks of, an open-endedness derived from a view of life as a series of stages of responsibility and withdrawal. So the same open-endedness can be seen in Narayan's treatment of power relation, in which ambivalence is the most prominent element. So this ambivalence is nowhere more evident than in the relationship between Rosie and Raju. So dominance of one over the other keeps shifting. Rosie speaks of her caste as socially inferior, and the Raju is infatuated by her, but she is quite clear in her mind about her inferior social position. When Raju says, "You married him because of his wealth," she explains to him patiently that it was not merely for wealth, but for social status that she married Marco. So there's a quotation that, "You see," she began, "plucking my sleeves. Can you guess to what class I belong? I looked her up and down and ventured, the finest, whatever it may be, and I don't believe in class or caste. You are an honor to your caste, whatever it may be. So I belong to a family traditionally dedicated to the temples as dancers. My mother, grandmother, and before her and her mother, even as a young girl, I danced in our village temple, you know, and how our caste is viewed. So it is the noblest caste on earth," I said. "We are viewed as public women," she said plainly, and I was thrilled to hear the word. "We are not considered respectable, and we are not considered civilized." So this was from the page 74 to 75 from the novel. So she then goes ahead with the description of her childhood days. Her mother planned a different life for her. She puts her to school, and Rosie finally earned her master's degree in economics. After that, it was through an advertisement that she got married to Marco, so much above our wealth and class. And she describes her husband as a rich man, and he had a big house, motor car, and he was a man of high social standing, and he had a house outside Madras, and he was living in it all alone, no family at all, and he lived with his books and papers. When Rajiv claims that she was lucky not to have a mother-in-law, she replies that she would have preferred any kind of mother-in-law had that meant having one real life husband. So it is clear that from the very beginning it was a marriage of convenience in which love had no part to play. So Raju was trying to escape, Rosie was trying to escape her inferior social status, and in the process entered into a matrimonial alliance in which she would have little emotions and control over her husband. So Marco is a man who is devoted to his study and who has little time for his wife. To Raju, he is a man who seemed to know everything beforehand. He was a very strange man who did not always care to explain what he was doing. Mikhail Paus considers Marco to be a person who has single, all-dominating interest in life. So Marco is, so it's a quotation. So Marco, an intellectual whose life was entirely devoted to the study of archaeology, who married to Rosie and who used to be a classical dancer. And she had to put an end to her dancing because her husband objected to it. Marco, altogether blind to the beauties of the world and to his wife's talent, treated her like a domestic animal. So when Raju and Rosie came closer, we noticed a subtle change in Rosie's behavior towards her husband. We are told that she was showing extra solicitude for him nowadays. She fussed a great deal over him. So the extra solicitude may reveal a guilty conscience, but we also learn that it was all the same to him. Rosie arranged his room and spoke to Joseph about his food, and Marco acknowledged it in an absent-minded, casual manner. So this kind of subtle domestic violence is partly responsible for creating a sense of being a victim in Rosie. So her relationship with Raju can be seen as a means of getting even with her husband. So Rosie's extramarital affair is known to Marco, and he reacts in a way that is typical of him. And here's a quote. "You are here because I am not a ruffian, but you are not my wife. You are a woman who will go to bed with anyone who flatters your antiques." It appears to Raju that even Othello was kinder to Desdemona. So Narayan's Othello, that's Marco, is in a sense superior to Shakespeare's Othello, and he handles the situation rationally and simply disowns Rosie, unlike Othello, who felt the need to kill Desdemona last. She should deceive more men. This is quite the different way of showing the nature of man. So Rosie makes an unconscious effort to lilt the balance of this unequal relationship in her favor. And her meeting Raju was a great opportunity because she discovered in him a means of freedom. And she loved dance. And if she could shape an identity and a destiny for herself through her art, then it would be quite welcoming and quite reduce her object dependence on her husband to some extent at last. So the parallel between Marco and Rosie's quest is it's quite unmistakable. In old case, Marco seeks the fulfillment of professional ambition, while in the living snake dance, Rosie tries to construct a less victimized self. So dance for Rosie is not only a means of self-fulfillment, but it's also a path of escape into the less suffocating world. So there's a quotation that I would like to quote, that her eyes lit with a new hope when I spoke about the dance, and it was, after all, her art that I first admired of late in our effort to live the lover's life. That all important question was pushed to the background, and her joy at finding shops, cinemas, and carousels made her forget for a while her primary obsession, but not for long. And she asked me one evening, point blank, "Are you also like him? In what way do you also hate to see me dance?" "Not at all. What makes you think so? And at one time you spoke like a big lover of art, but now you never give it a thought." So here, her art is important. Her art is important for Rosie, but it's important to note that there's a correlation that with her husband's position in life. So R.K. Narayan is a writer. Her husband and her art and her husband could not find a place in her thought at the same time. One drove the other out, and the psychological motivation of Raju and Rosie are quite different. For Raju, she is an elegant creature with whom he is infatuated. And to keep her close to him, he is ready to pretend that he has interest in art. And I didn't want her to interpret in an aversion on my on past to act. So that might drive her back into the arms of her husband. And so I look care to maintain the emphasis on my passion for the art. So Rosie as a dancer is an important subtext in the novel that carries an ambivalent discourse. And in the early pages of the novel, we can notice that Rosie and her heart and her art is everything, and her husband is merely an obstruction in the path of achieving that artistic fulfillment. And this interpretation is all right that as far as it goes, but it explains that, that Rosie says towards the close of the novel that Rosie is Nalini now as the pinnacle of fame, and the conversation being referred to takes place between Nalini and Raju in a train. So Nalini seems quite distracted, and Raju tells her, well, you have a big household, big car and whatnot. Is that not enjoyment of life? So Nalini replies moodily that how I wish I could go into a crowd, walk about, take a seat in audience and start out for an evening without having to make up or dress for stage. So this is merely a dangerous weariness. But her statement suggests more about the victimhood than would appear on the surface. She remains bound and dominated, and it's tempting to suggest that Narayan wants the reader to understand the essential and inescapable predicament of a woman who belongs to the social inferior class. So there's a nature and distribution of power and authority that's just shifting in the novel. And in the beginning, Rose's dependence on Raju is complete. And the Raju says that that was enough for her. My guidance was enough. And she accepted it absolutely, unquestioningly. And there was faith and ignored everything else completely. But gradually the balance tried to tilt and in favor of Rosie, and she invites artists, musicians and spend hours with them. And Raju feels it's quite not wanted, and he was quite found that he is not wanted over there. And this is a quotation from page 195 that says that I occasionally went up and chatted with them, always with the feeling that I was an interloper in that artistic group. Again, she felt annoyed at my interference. Why should you come and pull me out of company? Am I a baby? And finally, the shift in power is stated very definitely. I am now a sort of hanger on in the house. Even she has released me from police custody. The mastery passed to her. So R.K. Narayan is the guide. It shows up sort of paradigm shift of power in charting the course of vicissitudes in the life of its protagonist. At the level of the individual, the novel does show how a person transcends his ordinariness. And it's a novel in which a good-for-nothing guide is transformed into a sane and bold wife of a work-intoxicated scholar reaches artistic fame. So the novel, therefore, is about a fundamental change. If that is considered to be the main text, the subtext too must be considered important. So the subtext concerns itself with the pattern of dominance in which individuals' dream ambitions are subsumed under the need to control. So this political need often translates itself into the events of topography, of which may be interpreted differently. And it's quite the quality of multidimensionality that constitutes the excellence of guide. And there's a quotation from Bhagavad Gita that purification of the soul in R.K. Narayan is the guide. Whatever happened, happened well. What's happening, happens well. And all that is supposed to happen will happen well as well. What have you lost to cry? What have you brought to lose? What have you created to waste? Whatever is taken from here. Whatever that's given is given from here. And all that is yours today will be others tomorrow. And one another day, it will be someone else. This change is the law of nature. It's a quotation from Bhagavad Gita. So, so this was all about the R.K. Narayan's guide and the different the way of seeing it through the lenses of be it the feminist perspective or the very conflict between the real saint or the very questioning on the title, the guide, the very travesty of the title is also discussed here. So I would request Pratit Pavan sir to kindly intervene and do share his views regarding the novel. Am I audible to you, sir? Professor Patip, sir?
Yes, quite audible.
Yes, sir.
And he has beautifully portrayed the three characters of the novel, the guide, Raju, Rosie, and Marco. And in fact, Arkan Aran is one of the triumvirate of Indian literary scene at that time. The other two are, as you know, Mulk Raj Anand and Raja Rao. And the celebrities like John Woodpike or Somerset Maugham, or as you quoted, Graham Greene, they have a lot of praise for Arkan Aran, because Arkan Aran is one of the novelists in India who, I mean, we can say, if I can use the word, marketed India in the West. And this particular novel, as you rightly said, portrayed the characters in a beautiful way. And Arkan Aran was very much advanced from his time, because he could write about the living relationship between the two, Rosie and Raju. And this shows also a stand of gender empowerment, the liberation of women. Another thing that I would like to point out is that the use of imagery, and in Hindu mythology, water is a great purifier. It redeems the soul. And that's what happened in the end, when Raju enters the river and nobody knows what happens after that. So thank you very much. Congratulations. You have beautifully portrayed the novel, and we are seeing as if we are seeing in our mind's eye pages after pages of the novel. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. So I would like to thank the technical team and the participant who participated, and thanks to one and all for the session. So, Runita ma'am, can we wind up the session? Runita ma'am, am I audible to you?
Yes, Eva.
Yeah.
Now yeah. We are closing the session. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.